Good afternoon, everybody. This is Congressman Sarbanes. I want to welcome you to this forum that we've put together to talk about Medicare and Social Security, two very, very important programs. I'm thrilled that we're joined with some experts on those topics, which I will yield to them momentarily. But I did want to say that we try in every way we can to reach out to our constituents. Many of you I know participate in our telephone town halls on a regular basis. I thank you for doing that. This being Older Americans Month, in particular, we wanted to address some topics that are of concern to our seniors. And that's why we've gathered together this forum today. You're going to be hearing more about the Social Security and Medicare programs on the call. They're two of the most important programs ever passed into law in this country. If you look back over our history, they've lifted millions of people out of poverty. They've become a critical part, a lifeline for seniors across the country. They bring a sense of comfort and confidence as you enter retirement, knowing that those programs are there. And we're gonna do everything we can. I'm certainly doing my best every day to make sure that we keep those programs as strong and as robust as we possibly can. I know how important it is to seniors across the state of Maryland and of course across the country. There are many, many other things that we are focused on to try to lift up our seniors in addition to keeping those programs strong. One that I've brought a lot of attention to is lowering the cost of prescription drugs. In fact, right now we're working on legislation in Congress that would allow the Medicare program to negotiate on the price of prescription drugs, and that could help immensely in terms of lowering their costs. So I'll continue to do that work. That bill, as you may know, some of you, is named after the late Elijah Cummings, who fought very, very hard, our colleague in Congress from the state of Maryland. We also, as you know, I just wanted to mention, we're thrilled to be able to pass the American Rescue Plan that President Biden proposed and that both houses of Congress were able to get passed into law recently. That's brought some very significant support to seniors across the district. I'll just mention a few of them, certainly ramping up the distribution of vaccines, which in Maryland is going pretty well. And I want to thank seniors for really making sure that they seize that opportunity. We've had good uptake among our seniors in the state of Maryland. Increasing federal matching funds for the Medicaid program, which is very, very important to our seniors. Direct stimulus payments, $1,400 going out to individuals across the state. And then helping our seniors with affordability of rental payments, utilities, nutrition assistance, and other things that make such a difference in the quality of your lives. So we'll continue to focus on that. But as I say today, the principal purpose is to bring some experts to present to you on the Medicare and Social Security programs. So we're delighted to have joining us two presenters. Diana Varela, who's from the Social Security Administration. She's been there since 1995 as a bilingual service representative, and she's held many, many positions across the agency. And I want to thank her for joining us today, and she will be presenting shortly. And then Sharon Graham, who is the Regional Administrator for the Centers for Medicaid and Medicare Services, which administer the Medicare program. She joined CMS in 1992, currently serves as the national lead regional administrator for the open enrollment program at Medicare and the flu vaccination campaigns. So I wanna thank them for joining us, giving us a few minutes of their time. I'm gonna turn it first over to Diana Varela from the Social Security Administration. Diana, thank you so much for being with us today. We very much appreciate it.
Congressman Sarbanes, thank you so much for inviting us. On behalf of the Social Security Administration, thank you for inviting us, to you and your staff, and also to all of you attending And we hope that you and your families stay safe during this health crisis. And if I can get, please, first slide, and I will be letting you know how to contact. Okay, great. Thank you so much. I would like to let you know that Social Security Administration, our offices are open, but with limited staff in the offices, we have limited in-office visits. We encourage you to visit us online at socialsecurity.gov. There are many, many things that you can do online if you are not receiving your benefits or even if you are already receiving your benefits. So please, please visit us online, socialsecurity.gov or ssa.gov. Also, the other way to contact us is you can give us a call. Our toll-free number is 1-800-772-1213. Our representatives are ready to help you Monday through Friday from 8 a.m. to 7 p.m. They have extended hours so they can help you. And in the next slide, I would like to really applaud you for attending this seminar because retirement planning should start as early as possible. We'd like to encourage you to visit us online. We have many, many tools that will provide you with the information that you need to be ready when the time comes for retirement. You should only have Social Security as the foundation of the income that you have. I encourage you to create an online account because your online account will allow you, if you don't receive benefits yet, your online account will allow you to get the information that you need. You can review your earnings record. You can take a look at the benefits that you are eligible for. And of course, the amount of the benefits that you will get. If you remember, we used to mail the Social Security statement to all workers who were 25 years and older. We are only mailing the statement to workers that are 60 years and over. If you're not 60, like me, I'm not 60 yet, although I am getting there sooner than what I want, please take a look at creating an online account so you can get that information about your future benefits. If you're getting your benefits now, I still encourage you to create an online account because that's the way that you can manage your benefits. You can take a look at your payment history. You can take a look at the changes that you can make in your record. You can request information from your record through your online account in the comfort of your home. If you are 60 years, if you are getting the Social Security statement by mail, I still encourage you to create your online account because you will be getting closer to the age that you will have to file for benefits. And therefore, your application process will be faster. In the next slide, let's talk about who can be eligible to retirement benefits. There are two minimum requirements for retirement. One of them is you have to be at least 62 years old, at least 62 years old. And the other requirement is that you have 40 work credits. A credit is a measure of work. We are going to measure your work activity to determine what type of benefits you are eligible for. You earn one credit this year if you make earnings, have earnings, and of course you pay taxes over those earnings of $1,470. You can only get 4 credits in 1 year. As you can see, with $5,880 that a worker makes this year, will make enough money to get the 4 credits. For retirement, you need 40. For most workers, 10 years of work is the minimum number of years they need to work to be eligible for benefits. 10 years of work only. But there is a big difference between just working enough to get the credits to be eligible for the benefit, and then the number of years we will use in the calculation of your Social Security benefits. Take a look at the next slide. The next slide will provide you with information about how we are going to calculate your benefits. These are the first three steps we use in the calculation of your benefits. In the first step, we're going to take a look at all of the years you work. If you have worked for 45 years, we will take a look at 45 years. We will increase those earnings to current value because of wage levels over time, inflation. And then we are going to select 35 years of earnings. Then we get an average of monthly earnings. We apply a formula, and that is basically how we will determine your benefit. Now, in regards to the years that you have worked, some workers might not have 35 years. Then we will use whatever number of years they have and then put zeros in a sense, you know, and the rest of the years they don't have to equal 35. For workers who have maybe part-time employment, some of the years that we will use will be maybe at the beginning, in the middle, or at the end of their careers. For most of us, it's at the end of our careers that we have the higher years of earnings, but it doesn't really matter where your higher 35 years of earnings are. We will find them and we will use them in the calculation of your benefits. In the next slide, you will see the basic formula we use. It's going to be a different amount of benefits for all of us, because for each one of us, the amount of benefits that we will get from Social Security will depend basically on the number of years that you work, the earnings you had over those years, and the other factor that will impact the amount of benefits that you will get is the age in which you decide to get benefits. Remember that I said that you can file as early as 62 years old? And that is probably one of the questions that we always get, the number one question that we get. People ask us all the time, when is the best time to apply for benefits? And I can tell you that I don't have an answer for you. And I don't have an answer because it's going to be different for all of us. It depends on many, many different personal factors. But I can give you information on the options that we have in terms to applying for benefits. In the next slide, you will see the options that we have. One option is you can wait until you are your full retirement age. This slide actually talks a little bit about one of the factors that you need to take into consideration when filing for benefits, which is working. Working is one of the factors because a lot of workers need to have that additional income upon retirement. If you are actually working this year, if you file early at the age of 62, you are allowed to work, but you can only make $18,960. If you make that amount or less, we pay you benefits every month. And if you make more than that, if you're only 62 years old, filing under full retirement age, then we will take $1 of benefits for every $2 that you go over. If you are your full retirement age, it doesn't matter how much money you earn. We will pay you benefits every single month. It doesn't matter the amount of earnings you have. That is one of the incomes that impacts Social Security benefits is earnings. When you are under your full retirement age, and full retirement age is going to be different for all of us, because it depends on the year that we were born. But just know, please, that yes, you're allowed to work, and receive your Social Security benefits at the same time. Just remember that if you're not full retirement age yet, then you need to know how much you can earn before your earnings impact your benefits. Another factor that you have to take into consideration is payment of taxes over Social Security benefits. In the next slide, you will see that beneficiaries, people receiving benefits who have incomes of more than $25,000 for single taxpayers and $32,000 for couples, then be prepared, you're gonna have to pay taxes on some of your Social Security benefits. We are not the agency that actually has jurisdiction over taxes. I will not be able to answer questions that you might have on taxation of Social Security benefits, but we want you to be prepared. So my recommendation would be, number one, know what are the thresholds that will make you liable to pay taxes on Social Security benefits. And also, please contact the IRS. They have in their website at the bottom of the screen, you can see the name of a couple of publications that can help you find out if you have to pay taxes, number one. Number two, what is the rate of taxes that you will have to pay? They even have a tax withholding calculators that you can utilize so you can plan accordingly to those payments of taxes. In the next slide, you will find a little bit more of information if you want to do it yourself. Next slide, please. In regards to what is the formula, it's a very simple formula that you can use to calculate if your combined income will be above the thresholds or not. You will have to add all of your adjusted income plus non-taxable interest, an amount equal to 50% of your Social Security benefits. And if your combined income is above the thresholds, $25,000 for single taxpayers or $32,000 for couples, then you're gonna have to pay taxes on some of your benefits. Also know that you can request that the Social Security Administration deducts federal taxes out of your Social Security benefits, so that way you pay your taxes throughout the year. But it's all about personal choices, personal preferences. We have some beneficiaries that wait until they file their income tax return. That's when they pay their taxes. It's up to you. Just know that you can contact us to have those taxes withheld from your benefits. And going back to the number one question that we always get in regards to Social Security benefits, when is the best age to apply for benefits? And I told you that it's going to be different for all of us. What I can tell you is that you have different options. One is to wait until you are your full retirement age. That way you get 100% of your benefits. The chart tells you when your full retirement age is based on the year you were born. First column, year you were born. Second column tells you what is considered your full retirement age. And full retirement age means the age that you apply for benefits and there is no reduction. You get 100% of your benefits. Wait until that age, we pay you 100%. But remember that I said that you can file early at the age of 62. Happen to be that if you apply for benefits between 62 and what is considered your full retirement age, you are going to take a reduction and the reduction is permanent. The third column will tell you what is the reduction that you're taking. Let me give you an example. I was born after 1960. My full retirement age is 67. If I wait at 67, I get 100% of my benefits. However, if I start collecting my benefits early at 62, I will get a 30% reduction. The reduction is prorated by year, by month, actually, but it is about 6% reduction that I will be taking if I apply for my benefits between 62 and my full retirement age. since my full retirement age is 67, taking a benefit at 62, 5 years before, 6% per year, 30% reduction. There is one more option for you. You can actually wait until you are your full retirement age and still delay applying for benefits. If that is the case, you actually get an increase in your benefits from the time that you reach your full retirement age until the age of 70, and your increase will be 8% increase for every year that you wait to collect your benefits. Once again, remember, my full retirement age is 67. If I apply for my benefits at 70, 3 years later, I get 8% increase per year. At the age of 70, I will get 124% of my benefits. We're not telling you to wait until 70. We are telling you that you can file as early as 62. Do not delay your benefits past 70, because past 70, you do not get any more 8% increases. Any time in between those ages, 62 and 70, what is more convenient for you? I invite you to visit us online, because besides calculators and my Social Security online account, we have a great publication. We have tons of great publications, but one of them is actually a fact sheet called When to Start Receiving Retirement Benefits. It will give you different factors that you need to take into account to actually find the answer for yourself. Another factor that you really need to take into account will be family benefits. In the next slide, you will see that, yes, we can pay benefits to family members. And I like this slide because it's a comparison between when the worker is alive or the worker is deceased. A lot of times people believe that we only pay benefits when the worker is deceased, and that is not so. We pay benefits. Yes, we pay survivors' benefits. That's the column towards your right. As you can see, when a worker is deceased, we can pay benefits to spouses of any age if they have children in their care. And that for Social Security means a child under the age of 16 or a child that is even an adult, but it's an adult that is disabled and became disabled before the age of 22. We also pay benefits to survivors at the age of 60. Now, but take a look at the column towards your left. That's when the worker is alive. If we have a worker that is already receiving either retirement or Medicare benefits, we pay benefits to a spouse, any age, for as long as the spouse has a child in care. Once again, child in care is children under age 16 or children who are adults but disabled adults. We also pay benefits at the age of 62 or even at full retirement age. How much can my spouse get in benefits? Spouses can get an amount equal to 50% of the worker's full retirement age amount. In other words, if the worker is getting $2,000, a stay-home spouse that never work outside the household can potentially get $1,000. Next slide, you will see that besides the spouses, we also pay benefits to divorced spouses. And for divorced spouses, there are a couple of other requirements. The requirements are that they were married to the worker for 10 years and they are single at the time of application. Benefits that we can pay to a divorced spouse will not impact at all the benefits that we can pay to a current spouse if the worker has remarried. In the next slide, let's talk a little bit about a summary of a spousal benefits. Once again, the amount of a spousal benefit is 50% of the worker's full retirement age amount. What we pay to a spouse on a worker's record will not take any benefits away from the worker. We can pay the worker and the spouse. Couple of scenarios, one of them, as I said before, if we have a couple One is not working, one has been a stay-home spouse. If the worker is getting $2,000, the stay-home spouse will get $1,000. Total family benefit, $3,000. Of course, if that spouse applies for benefits before full retirement age, we will reduce that benefit too. When you look at benefits with us, any benefit that you apply early, it's going to be reduced. Now, take a look at the third bullet. When a spouse on benefit is less than 50% of the worker, we're going to combine. This is, for example, when we have a couple, both of them have work, but one of them had higher earnings. Maybe the other one, the other spouse, was only working part-time. Maybe did not work for a few years. In that scenario, let me give you an example. Let's say that the worker with the higher earnings record will get $2,000 of benefits at full retirement age. Potentially, a spouse is eligible for $1,000, right, as a spouse. Let's say that that spouse worked very little, only part-time, but can get on his or her own record $400. We will make a comparison all the time. If you're married, or if you have been married, if you work, or your ex-spouse or ex-spouse have worked, we have to compare which benefit will give you the higher. In this scenario, when we have one of the spouses who only working part-time, that can just get $400, but if we compare as a spouse, because the spouse had higher earnings, we can pay 1,000. We will say, basically, would you like to get 1,000 or only $400? You know what the answer will be, right? 1,000. We will pay them. We will combine the benefits. Still, that worker will get $400, but another $600 to equal the higher amount that the beneficiary is due. We're going to do this when you file for benefits. We'll take a look at how much you can get on your own, how much on your spouse's. We'll pay the higher of the two benefits that you're entitled. We will do this for you and also for your spouse. And in terms of family members, besides the spouses, children can also get benefits. In the next slide, you see the requirements for children. And these are the same requirements for children when the worker is alive or the worker is deceased. All children under the age of 18 can get monthly benefits, or children between ages 18 and 19, but still in high school in full-time attendance. And also children who are of any age but are disabled and became disabled before the age of 22. They can get benefits. Same amount of benefits for a child that is disabled when the worker is alive. Children get an amount equal to 50% of the worker's full retirement age amount. We have a worker who is getting $2,000. A disabled adult child will get $1,000. If the worker is deceased, we can pay 75% of the benefits. In the next slide, you will see information about a very, very useful calculator that we have, the retirement estimator. I know that I told you about creating an online account so you can take a look at the benefits that you will be eligible for. And that is great. I love the Social Security statement, and you can get access to your statement through your online account. But the statement is really a projection. We think, we assume you will continue working and you will either apply for benefits at 62, full retirement age, or even 70 years old. And we give you that information. But with the retirement estimator, what happens is that we will actually allow you to play different scenarios. What if I actually stop working? Or what if my earnings increase or decrease? What if I don't want to apply at 62 because I don't want to take all that reduction? But hey, I don't want to wait until 70 either. Remember that I said that the benefits that we will get paid depend on your earnings, the number of years you work, and also the age in which you decide to retire. With the statement, we project that you will continue working, having about the same amount of earnings. But with the retirement estimator, you can play what if scenarios. Please create your online account, use the retirement estimator. And if you're married, I strongly recommend that both of you have an online account, because then that way you can take a look at what amount of benefits you can get at full retirement age. And remember that your spouse can get an amount equal to 50% of your full retirement age amount. If you see that your spouse at full retirement age is getting less than what they can get on your record, you know there will be an adjustment. How do you file for benefits when you are ready, when you use all of these resources that I talked to you about? Two easy ways to do it. Once again, we came back to how to contact Social Security. You can complete your application entirely online when visiting ssa.gov. It's very convenient. You can complete the application online, or you can give us a call at the toll-free number or contact your local office to schedule a telephone appointment. Whatever way that you decide that you want to get your benefits, apply for your benefits, please, please contact us 3 months before you want your benefits to start. 3 months before. And the application is also for retirement and Medicare. You can even just apply for Medicare if you are not ready to get your cash benefits. And I know that Sharon will be talking to you about Medicare, but to get Medicare, you apply with Social Security Administration, and these are the two easy ways to apply for retirement, for Medicare, for both at the same time. And besides encouraging you to create your online account, in the next slide, you will see that I invite you to visit us online, because we not only have publications, but we have newsletters, we have blogs that you can register. We can, if you're a fan of Facebook or other social media, you can connect with us through Facebook. If you have any questions, you can send us a question by Facebook. Like a good friend, we will respond to you. So please visit us online, contact us. And thank you so much once again, Congressman Sarbanes, for inviting us. I'll stay on the line.
Yes, thank you very, very much, Diana. We appreciate your sharing all that information. The viewers can definitely see why these public affairs specialists are so critical, because you bring a wealth of experience and insight. And that was a very, very helpful presentation. I'll relay a few questions at the end of the overall forum today. But now we'd like to move quickly to Sharon Graham, who I mentioned is here from the Centers for Medicaid and Medicare Services, and is going to present some good information about the Medicare program. I'll turn it over to you, Sharon.
Good afternoon. Thanks, Congressman Sarbanes. Really appreciate the time to connect with your constituents today about getting started with Medicare. Next slide, please. So what is Medicare? Medicare is health insurance primarily for people age 65 and over. And what I want to point out, which is really critical in line with what we just heard too from Diana, is that Medicare is no longer tied to your actual eligibility date for Social Security anymore. You saw the one slide where now for people born after 1960, you become eligible for Social Security for full retirement at age 67. It's no longer tied to Medicare at age 65. And that's really important to understand, because you may have to apply for Medicare at age 65 and make that extra effort to do so, as opposed to trying to tie it in your mind in with Social Security. For those who are under age 65, there is an option for Medicare coverage if you're deemed to be disabled by Social Security. That isn't disabled through an employer or getting workers' compensation. You have to go to Social Security and apply for disability. And if you are deemed eligible for disability by Social Security, your Medicare will start 2 years after the date of that initial eligibility. For people who have ALS or Lou Gehrig's disease, there actually is no waiting time and you can become eligible for Medicare upon diagnosis. And for those people who also have end-stage renal disease, there's a waiting period involved there as well. But just to point out that it's those who are disabled with ALS or have ESRD who can be eligible for Medicare under age 65. And as the note there says, you do have to be a U.S. citizen or lawfully present in the U.S. for at least 5 years to be eligible for Medicare. The picture you see there on the right is our Medicare and You handbook. It is mailed to every single household, not every single person, but every single household in September of each year. And it's just a great resource. And I point that to you for any additional information that I may not cover today for you there as well. Next slide, please. So who's responsible for Medicare? We actually split it out a little bit. You already heard from Diana with Social Security, and that's where you apply for your Medicare coverage. And Social Security is who deems you eligible for Medicare. And at that point, once you're eligible for Medicare, then CMS, our agency that you see there on the right, the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, at that point, we become responsible for your Medicare coverage. If you're a railroad retiree, the Railroad Retirement Board actually has a component that manages your Medicare benefits for you through the RRB. And then for people who are federal retirees, the OPM, the Office of Personnel Management, is also involved. But ultimately, it is CMS who's responsible for your record. Next slide, please. So what are your Medicare options? Original Medicare is what everybody receives on default when you sign up for Medicare. So that consists of Medicare's Part A, B, and D. Medicare Part A is your inpatient or your hospital insurance. It also covers rehab facilities, what we call skilled nursing. Also covers home health care and hospice care. Part B is sort of everything else. It's like your outpatient coverage, preventive benefits, doctor's visits, if you go to a lab, all those outpatient visits are covered under Part B. Part D, consider D stands for prescription drugs, D for drugs. That is an optional benefit. I'll talk a little bit more about it later, but it's prescription drug coverage for people on Medicare. Now, Medicare has certain cost sharings with it. There's an annual deductible and there's co-payments that go with every service received. I should say most services received require a co-payment. So you can purchase on your own what we call supplemental insurance, or otherwise known as Medigap, might be a term that you're familiar with. And that supplemental coverage does exactly that. It supplements and covers those out-of-pocket costs that original Medicare has with it. Now, another option to receive your Medicare benefits is through what's called a Medicare Advantage Plan, also known as Medicare Part C. Now, if you have a Medicare Part C plan, you have all of the benefits available to you under original Medicare. So you have A, B, and most plans will cover prescription drugs also. You do get, for most plans, extra benefits. Many of them will cover hearing aids, for example, or vision services. Some will cover gym coverage. There's a lot of different supplemental or additional benefits that those plans will cover. Now, Medicare Advantage services often will have a co-payment associated with them as well, and a Medicare supplemental plan will not cover those out-of-pocket costs. So you cannot use Medicare supplement coverage with a Medicare Advantage plan. But typically, those out-of-pocket costs will be lower than your out-of-pocket costs for original Medicare. So it's important that you look at all of your options. As we like to say, consider cost, coverage, and convenience. What is the cost for you from a premium standpoint? How about out-of-pocket costs that you might have to pay under both scenarios? The coverage, you know, should be about the same again for Medicare A, B, and D, but there are those extra benefits available to most plans under Medicare Plus Choice or Medicare Part C, Medicare Advantage. And then the convenience, of course, is about the convenience for you and your doctors and the hospitals that you go to. Medicare Advantage plans contract with networks of doctors. And oftentimes you need to look at the networks that they contract with and make sure that your doctor is in that network of providers. You may also want to look at their pharmacies that they contract with to make sure that your pharmacy, should you choose prescription drug coverage, is available in that particular Medicare Advantage plan. Next slide, please. So this is the red, white, and blue card that everybody receives once they enroll with Medicare. And a couple of years ago, we updated this to change to a unique identifier for each individual that is not your Social Security number. For those of you listening today who have an older Medicare card, you would know and remember that your Medicare number was your Social Security number. In some cases, it may have been your spouse's social security number and typically had a letter at the end. And if you were railroad retirement, typically had a letter at the beginning. There is inherently a safety risk with that. And so several years ago, Medicare took on the task of updating everybody with a unique Medicare beneficiary identifier. And there's an example of one right there on this on the sample card there. So when you receive that in the mail, if you're already receiving Social Security benefits, you'll automatically be prompted to sign up for Medicare. But if you're not receiving Social Security benefits, you will have to reach out to Social Security to sign up. But you'll want, if you want to accept your Medicare coverage, you can just keep your card and carry it with you. We don't suggest that you laminate it. Some people do that. We don't suggest that you do that. But you don't necessarily need to carry your card at all times, but we do encourage you to carry it when you're away from home, should you need any Medicare coverage away from your routine doctors or hospital visits you might have. If you do happen to lose your Medicare card, though, you can always call 1-800-MEDICARE. That's our telephone line, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It's available to you. And for those of you who prefer to use the internet, Medicare.gov allows you to create what we call a MyMedicare.gov account there. And you can access a lot of your Medicare claims there. And you can also request a replacement card at MyMedicare.gov also. Next slide, please. So just to go into a little more detail about what Parts A and Part B covers, as I mentioned, for Medicare Part A, it's going to cover inpatient care in the hospital. You'll see it's a semi-private room, and I won't read everything here, but it does cover your inpatient hospitalization with an out-of-pocket copayment. It does also cover inpatient care in a skilled nursing facility if you've been an inpatient in the hospital for 3 days prior to your transfer to the skilled nursing facility. Next slide, please. Now for Part A, it also covers, as I mentioned, hospice and home health, does cover blood if you receive it while an inpatient, and coverage in a specific type of facility called a religious non-medical healthcare institution. That's not a very frequent occurrence, but wanted to make sure that you were aware of that particular coverage as well. Next slide, please. So the question about signing up for Part A, it is free for most people. You pay into the Medicare Trust Fund over the course of your employed history, or perhaps someone else within your family, such as a spouse. And as long as there is 40 quarters of coverage, we call that 40 quarters, calendar quarters in which you paid into the trust fund, it will be free for most people. Although you can purchase it with a premium if needed, if you do need Part A and don't have that 40 quarters of coverage. If you have to sign up though, there could be a penalty if you delay signing up around your initial enrollment period. And one last thing, as health savings accounts become more popular, want to encourage those of you to stop contributions to your health savings account in order to avoid penalties from the IRS once your Medicare starts. Next slide, please. So Medicare Part B, as I mentioned, this is really your outpatient services, and there's a whole list there: doctors, lab tests, durable medical equipment, walkers, wheelchairs, preventive health services, and preventive health services are covered without an out-of-pocket cost, so you'll get those for free. Outpatient home health care, it's unlike the inpatient home health care Medicare Part B will cover, mental health services, and lots of your outpatient therapies like physical and occupational therapies as well. Next slide. This, I mentioned preventive services are free for people, and this is a very comprehensive list of those type of preventive services that Medicare will cover with no out-of-pocket cost for you. We always like to encourage our Medicare beneficiaries to take care of your health and take full advantage of the availability of these preventive services. Next slide, please. What's not covered by Medicare Part A and Part B? For example, most routine dental care is not covered. Eye exams and dentures, cosmetic surgery, massage therapy, routine physical exams, except for your Welcome to Medicare physical. Everybody does have access to a Welcome to Medicare physical, which is the first one that's covered when you are eligible for Medicare. Hearing aids and exams, for example, long-term care, that would be if you need just help with your activities of daily living in a nursing home, Medicare will not cover. As I mentioned, some of these particular services might be covered by a Medicare Advantage plan. So it's important that you look at Medicare Advantage plans in your area if some of these particular types of services not covered by original Medicare are in fact important to you. Next slide, please. So the question about keeping or signing up for Medicare Part B, You will pay a monthly premium. And I would encourage you, if you're also looking at Medicare Advantage, look at that monthly premium as it compares to a Medicare Advantage premium. For most people, you're going to have that deducted from your Social Security or your railroad retirement benefits, although there is an option to pay your premium directly. And the premium amount does depend on income. So people over a certain income threshold will pay a higher Part B premium. Now, your Medicare coverage, if you continue to remain employed after age 65, you don't have to pick up Medicare. You can, in fact, still keep your employer coverage, but sign up for Part B, and then your Medicare will serve as a supplement to cover most, if not all, of those out-of-pocket costs that you might incur under your employer's healthcare coverage. So even if you continue to work and have healthcare coverage, look and see if Part B may help to reduce your overall out-of-pocket expenses. Next slide, please. There are some times in which you do have to have both Medicare Part A and Part B. So for example, if you have original Medicare coverage and you want to buy a Medicare supplement, a Medigap plan, you will need to have Medicare Part A and Part B. If you want to join a Medicare Advantage plan, you also have Medicare Part. You need to have Medicare's Part A and B. Or if you're eligible for any of the VA type benefits like TRICARE for Life, CHAMP VA, or the civilian health and medical programs there through the VA. And in some cases, if you're with a small employer, they may require you to pick up Medicare Part A and Part B. Large employers can't do that, but those that have less than 20 employees may require you to pick up Medicare Part A and Part B. And whenever there's employer insurance involved, we always encourage you to speak with the benefits administrator at your particular employer or with your union. Next slide, please. So Medicare Part D is, as I mentioned, prescription drug coverage, and it's optional. You don't have to pick up Medicare Part D. However, do know if you don't pick up Part D, there is also a small penalty if you delay enrollment. It's 1% a month for every month you could have had Part D, but otherwise chose not to have prescription drug coverage. We, CMS, do contract with private companies to run the Medicare Part D program. I should also note that for Medicare Part C, Medicare Advantage, those are also private health insurance companies that the government contracts with. And those plans that we contract with are called prescription drug plans or PDPs. And for those Medicare Advantage plans that offer prescription drug coverage, we call those MAPDs for Medicare Advantage plus the prescription drug coverage. Next slide, please. So Part D, as I mentioned, is optional. You can choose any plan that operates in your particular area. And I encourage you, there's lots of different plans with lots of different formularies, we call them. That's the drugs that they cover and the amount at which you may have to pay out-of-pocket costs. Typically, the least expensive are in tier one plans, we'll call it, and the most expensive will be in tier four. So you need to look at the plans and make sure that they cover the drugs that you are currently taking. That's the formulary, as we call it. So your out-of-pocket costs will vary based on the tier of drugs. Your out-of-pocket costs will also vary depending on which pharmacy you use. And as the last bullet notes here, if you have limited income and resources, there is an extra help program available to help reduce those out-of-pocket costs for you if you're of limited means. Next slide, please. So Medicare Advantage here, just to touch on this briefly, again, it is called Medicare Part C. You may hear that term interchangeably. It's offered by those private health insurance companies that we call Medicare Advantage plans, and you will receive your Medicare benefits through the plan. So you don't lose your Medicare once you sign up for it. It's just that you're choosing to have those benefits administered by that Medicare Advantage plan. And as the very last bullet notes, and I've said before, those Medicare Advantage plans will contract with different providers. And so the whole universe of eligible providers are not, you cannot take advantage of in a Medicare Advantage plan. You need to look to make sure that your doctor, your hospital, your pharmacy even is contracted with that Medicare Advantage plan. Next slide, please. So again, I just mentioned this, you're in Medicare, you get all the rights and protections, you get all of the services covered by Medicare Part A and Part B. The difference is that the plans may put on you different requirements in order to access certain types of care. So for example, to have a surgery, you would need to have it pre-authorized, that is pre-approved by the Medicare Advantage plan in order to get that surgery. The out-of-pocket costs will be different with a Medicare Advantage plan than with original Medicare. And in some cases, those charges could be higher. There just needs to be what we call equivalence in terms of the out-of-pocket costs. So the plans may choose to vary that depending on the services. But there is a yearly limit to your out-of-pocket costs in a Medicare Advantage plan. That will also vary depending on plan. So you do want to look at that carefully. Next slide, please. So as I noted earlier, each plan has a service area. So it could be if you are in one county and your best friend is in another county, you may not have access to the same plan. So it's important to look at what we call their service area. Again, we talked about the provider asking for particular types of services to be pre-authorized, and most plans will actually do that as well. How it works on our side is that CMS pays each of those plans a monthly amount to administer those Medicare benefits on our behalf. And once we hand over that particular monthly capitation amount, we call it, the plan will get no more money. They have to be able to manage your care within the dollars that they've received. And as we note there, hospice is covered, but it actually is original Medicare that will cover the hospice services if you need to take advantage of hospice while still enrolled in a Medicare Advantage plan. You don't have to disenroll. Next slide, please. So for those of you for limited income and resources, we have a couple of programs that are available to you. There is a Medicare savings program that is run by every different state. They will cover, depending on your level of income, all the out-of-pocket costs to a certain amount, and even the premiums, depending on your income and your resources. There's extra help, as I noted, paying for prescription drug costs, and you can apply through Social Security, actually, to access that extra help. Medicaid is a state-run program as well for those of limited means, typically for those people who are under age 65 accessing Medicaid. Once you become eligible for Medicare, however, you can take that Medicaid with you if you're of limited income. And then for children, there is the Children's Health Insurance Program, which is also run by our states. Next slide, please. And these are just a couple of online resources for those of you who like to access extra help with the internet. I mentioned the Medicare and You Handbook earlier, of course, but here we have medicare.gov, great and easy to remember. And there's lots of terrific resources, including you can look for certain items that are covered and do what we call a plan compare to see if there's a Medicare Advantage plan that's right for you in your area. Medicaid.gov, of course, speaks to our Medicaid program run by our states. Social Security, this was already mentioned earlier, socialsecurity.gov. For those not eligible for Medicare or Medicaid, you may want to check out our health insurance marketplace, which is open right now through August 15th, healthcare.gov. And that's a great place for those who don't have other insurance options available to them to see if they're eligible. And would strongly encourage you, as the Congressman said earlier, the American Rescue Plan Act offered additional subsidies for people to access. And we think that about 75% of people who don't have health insurance right now will be able to receive some sort of subsidized health insurance through healthcare.gov. Children's Healthcare Program, the CHIP program, is insurekidsnow.gov. And we do have a national training program for our constituents who are willing to help their friends also learn more about Medicare. And we have local boots on the ground, as we like to say, resources that are available right in your community, the State Health Insurance Program, that we train them every year. And you can find more information there at chiptacenter.org. Last slide. Actually, I think that is the last slide. So with that, let me turn it over to the Congressman for any questions.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Sharon. And again, thank you to Diana. Those were terrific presentations. And I'm glad we had a good turnout on the call today for people to listen to that. We're also going to make sure that that information is made available as we move forward, because it was extremely valuable. I did want to ask a couple of questions. These are things that have come in from our constituents in anticipation of these presentations. And you can imagine we get a lot of questions that fall into the same basket. So let me start, Sharon, with you. We got one question. This was from a constituent of mine, Deborah, who was contacting us from Laurel, which is in my district. And the question was, when do those retiring at their full retirement age who remain employed with employer-based health insurance need to enroll in Part B in order to avoid a penalty? Because I know there can be some penalties there depending on your status as a continuing employee.
Thank you for that question. Yeah, that's a really good question. And so for people who are continue to remain employed, and that's really important, you need to be employed and receiving your health care insurance coverage through your active employment. You can wait, you can wait until the time in which you retire before signing up for Medicare Part B. And that active employment can be for yourself or it can be for a spouse, actually. But it's important to know that you have to be actively employed. This does not include COBRA coverage. That's really where sometimes people get tripped up. There needs to be active employment. And so at the point in which you're ready to retire, there's an 8-month window actually to sign up for Medicare. And that 8-month window starts on the date in which the employment ends. And then you have 8 months to sign up for Medicare Part B without a penalty.
Got it.
And the penalty, the penalty is 10% a month for every month you could have had Part B but did not sign up.
Got it. Okay. That's very helpful. Another quick question for you. People often can get confused about how these Medicare supplemental insurance programs relate to their overall coverage. And I just wondered if you had some guidance on how somebody knows. This came from Cheryl in Ellicott City, who wanted to know which Medicare supplemental insurance program is best for her. How does somebody determine that? I know you probably can't identify specific plans, but if you have sort of a strategy for people to choose among the different supplemental plans, that could be helpful.
Sure. So as I noted in the presentation, a Medigap plan only works when you have original Medicare. So again, people who enroll in Medicare Advantage plans cannot enroll in a Medigap plan. And the Medigap plan will pay for your out-of-pocket costs and only certain out-of-pocket costs. So there are 10 standardized Medigap plans, and they have different letters associated with them, and they're available through different private insurance companies. And in fact, it's the state that oversees Medigap plans and not the federal government. So what you need to look at it are those Medigap plans and determine how much coverage you'd like for those Medicare out-of-pocket costs. They all have letters and every single one is standard. So let me say Medigap plan A has the same coverage regardless of whether you're in Maryland or New Jersey or Pennsylvania. The coverage is the same. It's the premium that varies. So you need to consider your individual comfort level with the out-of-pocket costs that you're paying and the amount of coverage that you'd like to have as compared to the premium for that plan. So you can go to our Medicare.gov website and actually just search for the word Medigap and you'll find a Medigap plan compare where you can walk through the steps to see what plans are available in your area. And then you can look for additional information on what those plans cover and how much that'll cost.
Terrific. I must say this was very helpful for me because I was following along both presentations. I turned 59 this past Saturday, so I'm starting to get
happy birthday
closer to that critical age, and very much interested in this information and getting prepared, as I know you're hoping others will do, because it never hurts to anticipate. And obviously, these resources that both of you have described are designed so that people can begin to plan ahead in terms of accessing these benefits at the appropriate time. Diana, here's a question we got over Facebook from Fran, who asked if an individual is receiving Social Security disability, how do they transition their retirement benefits into sort of their retirement benefits once they reach that appropriate age? What does that look like, that sort of handoff look like? I think you may be muted, Diana.
Okay, thank you. I couldn't unmute myself, so thank you so much. Well, basically what will happen is that once the person that has been receiving disability benefits turns full retirement age, we will just change the name of the benefit, because once a person starts receiving disability disability, we do not reduce the benefits, regardless the age when the person started receiving the benefits. So at full retirement age, the benefit just changed the name, the payment is still the same. We have been already paying full retirement age benefits to the person.
Got it. Thank you.
Sharon. No need to apply for it.
Okay.
You're welcome.
Sharon, back to you. This is Jana from Columbia. I wanted to know, aside from the initial welcome visit, what exams and services are beneficiaries entitled to each year without paying out-of-pocket costs under the Medicare program?
Yes, and I had the slide that had the whole list right there in front of me, and perhaps you can post those slides on your website too when we finish today, because there are a whole host of them. I just want to call out that you do need to have Medicare Part B, and we always encourage people to talk with their provider for some of those services, because they just may not make sense, like a cardiovascular screening may not necessarily be appropriate for you at that time, but when it would be appropriate and a doctor would order it, then it would be free for a particular person out of pocket. And the list continues to grow. It used to be that there was only one or two preventive services that were covered, and that started actually with vaccines. Flu and pneumococcal vaccines are free for people with Medicare, for example. But if you recall, there was just a whole lot of bullets, I think about 20 different services out of pocket, where the out of pocket cost is zero. I can either send that separately to you to share with your constituents, Congressman, or direct people to medicare.gov, where you can also find that full list.
Great. Thanks very much. Well, we've run out of time, unfortunately, because I'm sure I could keep asking you questions until the cows came home. So I want to thank again Diana Varela from the Social Security Administration. Diana, thank you so much for joining us today, and Sharon Graham from CMS, very, very helpful. I hope that this was useful for those who are watching. And again, we will make that available to people as we move forward. In addition to all of the different resources and contact information that Sharon and Diana listed, that you can make use of. You can always call my office at 410-832-8890 during daytime hours. You can go to my website at sarbanes.house.gov. There's a lot of information there. We certainly have appropriate links when it comes to the Medicare program, the Social Security program. So please take advantage of those resources. Again, May, the Older Americans Month, is a time to celebrate the contributions that our seniors are making, really lifting up our communities at a critical moment. We know we've been through a very difficult time over the last year. We are beginning, we believe, to emerge from this terrible storm of the pandemic, the economic fallout, the displacement that it created, the separations of family members from each other, which has been very painful and caused a lot of stress. But I do want to come back and thank our seniors who really took advantage of the opportunity to get the vaccine at the appropriate time. And they've helped certainly here in the state of Maryland get us to a pretty good level of vaccination. We're not where we need to be quite yet. So use your voices that are powerful within your own families, extending to the next generation and beyond, the imperative of getting these vaccinations so we can get back to some sense of normalcy. We will continue to provide as much information and resources as we can to assist you. But again, I want to thank our presenters from today for sharing really good information about these two amazing programs that serve our seniors, but really serve all of us, serve our country and families in every state across the nation. So thank you for attending. And again, thank you to our presenters. All the best.